I was like, God, I need to hear from you. I am exhausted and I don't know how I'm going to do this. And I felt like I heard the voice of the Lord say, go take a nap.
I'm JJ Heller.
And I'm Dave Heller.
And this is Instrumental.
In every episode, we explore the instrumental moments that made our guest who they are today.
We hope our conversation reminds you that every second matters, because none of us knows which moment will be the one that changes everything.
Big love happens in the small moments.
Hey everybody, it's JJ.
And her husband Dave.
And we are thrilled to share with you a very lovely conversation that we had with our delightful friend, Ellie Holcomb.
She's really nice.
She's kind of like sunshine personified.
Yeah, like her hair is the color of sunshine.
That is true as well. If you are not familiar with Ellie's music, you will love it.
Ellie is a singer-songwriter here in Nashville, Tennessee, and she's married to Drew Holcomb from Drew Holcomb and The Neighbors. Ellie was, in fact, a part of his band for several years, and now she has a music career all her own.
She's also an author.
She's written a couple of children's books. She has a new devotional coming out this fall.
She's a very busy lady. And I'm so glad that she took time to talk with us, because you guys are going to enjoy this conversation. It was really fun for me to hear Ellie's stories because we have so much in common. She plays music with her husband and I play music with my husband.
That's me.
And we both experience what it's like to have children along with us and babies along with us on the road. And it's quite an adventure.
And actually, there is a special little moment at the end of this conversation, because we sort of wrapped up the interview. I was packing up all of the gear.
All the microphones were put away. The cords were being wrapped up.
We're just kind of chatting with Ellie, and she launches into this story. And I was like, I can't believe you're telling us this.
We need to record this right now.
So I just like, I got out my phone and I handed it to her. And she told the story into my phone. And if you stick around until the end, you'll hear that bonus little Easter egg at the end of the episode.
Yeah, it was just too good not to include. We're familiar with Ellie now because of her music and because of the books that she's written. But she actually went to school to become an English teacher. Things quickly went in a different direction. Here's Ellie.
I swore that I would never marry a musician. Swore that I would not be a musician. I got my master's in education. I was signing up to be a 12th grade English teacher. And the job that I got here in Nashville, right after I got married to my musician husband, Drew, was an 8th grade English teaching position.
That's very different.
It is very different. I cried when I interviewed for the 12th grade position. In the interview at Eastlip Magnet School, Drew and I were newly married. He was taking whatever gigs that he could get. I was teaching during the week and then joining him to sing background vocals on the weekend. And it was halfway through my first year of teaching. We were actually in a deer blind. Early morning, the sun was rising. So beautiful out there. It's hill country down in Texas where my dad grew up. I remember Drew, he was super lonely on the road. And he just said, I know that you love teaching. I know you love it so much. And I think you're so good at it, because I know you care about these kids and you want to call good things out of them. But is there any way you would ever consider joining me on the road? You know, singing with me, because I got my master's in education. I felt very called to education. And yet I felt very called to Drew. Mm. I was like, I think I'm going to wonder. Like, I think I'm going to be curious, like, what that would have been like to just make music with my husband. And so we decided, it was a huge leap of faith. We didn't know how we were going to pay any of our bills. But I went into my principal's office and I said, I think I'm going to go try this for a year. And if you'll just consider me when I come back begging for my job in a year, that would be great. And so we took this like huge leap of faith and I packed up my classroom and we drove to Young Life Camp. College, I was like a bad version of Taylor Swift, y'all. Truly. I was having my heart broken a lot in my college years before Drew and I was singing about it. I would sing in the dorm room stairwell, because it sounds the best in there. Y'all know. All that concrete just echoes. It sounds so good. And then B, it wouldn't wake up my roommate who went to bed way earlier than I did. I would be playing these songs in the dorm room stairwell, have my eyes closed, just being in the moment late at night. And inevitably what would happen after just being in this song, there are girls, there's over 20 girls lining the stairwell. Not all of them sober for sure. and many of them crying. And what ended up happening is so many of them ended up sitting down on the steps across from me and saying, thank you so much for playing that song. Oh, I've been going through the hardest. And they just started telling me their stories. I literally was like, hi, I'm Ellie. Nice to meet you. So I think for me, I have that my favorite thing about music is that it is a bridge builder. And so we pack up, we go to Young Life Camp, and we are playing our songs at Young Life Camp. And the same exact thing happens. I am sitting in the North Carolina hills, because I've played a song, these high school girls feel like they can tell me their whole story. We got our CD sales from the end of the week, and you're volunteering your time there. But the CD sales that week were way lower than we thought. I called my mom and dad and I said, I know that God made me to do this. Like, I am in the sweet spot. I'm getting to use music to connect with people, and I don't have to grade any papers. This is amazing. And so I knew that we were doing what we were supposed to be doing. And in the same breath, I also knew that we could not pay our bills a week. And so it was this crazy both and that week. Our hearts just sank when they told us the CD sales. Playing music is a risk. Y'all know it's a roller coaster. And it was really amazing. The store came back to us and they were like, oh my gosh, we actually got the numbers wrong. Like, you sold more CDs than we actually thought. It's actually like the most that's been sold here in a while. And it was just this beautiful moment of saying like, okay, we're not going to leave. We're going to keep showing up and get the beautiful opportunity to be held up by a community of people who see what we're doing and who are affirming what we're doing. And so we started doing NACA shows. Do y'all know this?
National Association of Campus Activities.
That's exactly right.
It's great because you're staying busy, but the downside is you're playing cafeterias and people are putting their headphones on.
Yeah.
Right.
Or one time the cafeteria was under construction, so they put us in the study hall room, which I'm like, this is a terrible idea. And, you know, a kid came in, there was a piano in there. You know, you're playing a show and he comes in and he starts practicing his scales in the middle of your set. And you're just like, oh man, this is really hard. And no one was telling me their stories at the community colleges, at the NACA shows, but it did pay our bills. And so, and it was really beautiful to be together. Well, I remember we rolled up in the middle of a NACA show run. We come to Eddie's attic, which is this beautiful little upstairs listening room in Decatur, Georgia, right outside of Atlanta. It's actually where John Mayer got his start. He played in that room early days. And Eddie, the owner of Eddie's Attic, would always be sitting there ready when you hauled up those creaky stairs with all your gear. And he would be usually smoking a pipe. He felt like a musical grandfather and would hear how you're doing. Well, we were opening this night for an artist called Jennifer Daniels. And she was singer-songwriter girl, and her husband played guitar with her. They were so kind, and they just felt sort of like an example for us to be like, okay, look, they're still doing this.
It's
you
possible.
Know, 7 years down the road, it's possible. Maybe we could make this work. They were always just so warm and kind to us. And Jennifer said, how are you guys doing? We just said, well, we're okay, but we've been on this NACA run, and it's just been honestly pretty awful. And she and her husband did NACA shows as well. I love that we have this in common. Y'all know they are just so
shared pain,
so rarely okay. She was like, oh, man, I know. I feel you so much. She was like, do you know something that has helped me so much in doing the NACA show circuit? And we were like, what? And she was like, you know, I actually just started praying for people that weren't listening to me. Because I thought, maybe the reason, God, that you have me here is that this person has never been prayed for in their life. And she was like, it honestly really helped. And I was like, yeah. All of a sudden, it was this major shift for me, because I realized that the purpose of a stage probably wasn't about me. It was a place of service. Offer love and light. Even when it wasn't a great circumstance for me, I could still be a conduit of love and light and hope. That, I think, has marked every show that I've ever done since where people didn't listen. And it marks every show that I play now. It's how we talk to our kids. If we ever invite them on the stage with us, we say, what's a stage for? And they say, to bring joy into the world.
Wow. It's amazing how a little perspective shift like that can change everything. I mean, because the expectation is I sing and then your response should be,
you admire me.
Right. And like, that's kind of the deal. That's the social arrangement. And that's why playing those NACA shows can be so painful, because they're not holding up their end of the bargain.
That's right.
But if you go into it thinking like, they probably won't clap for me, but how can I serve them anyway?
Yeah.
It's like, it's such an amazing way to reframe the whole experience.
It changed everything for me. We got this call one day, and it's from Oprah's team.
What?
Yeah. So we're like, oh my goodness, Oprah's heard. This is going to be the moment that breaks us. And so they're like, Oprah heard. So Drew wrote this song called Live Forever. His sister had told us they were moving to Panama, the country, and they were home. Like, they were true north. You know, for us, we would get home from hard times on the road and come home, and those kids ran up to us like we were the king and queen of the world. Like, they just were a very centering place for us. When Drew found out they were moving to Panama, he was so sad. And so he just sat down in like 10 minutes and wrote this song for them, not for anybody else. He wasn't thinking about what opportunity this was going to create. He just wrote a song to send them on their way, hoping that light beats out the darkness, you know, for them. Laughter is the only thing that'll keep you sane. And this world is dying more and more every day. Don't let evil get you down in this madness spinning round and round. And then I love the line about Christmas. Some people say faith is a childish game.
Play on, children, like it's Christmas Day. Sing me a song, sing me a melody. Sing out loud your symphony. I want you to.
And sure enough, we get this call that Oprah had heard this song, Live Forever. She was doing a whole commercial about not texting and driving. And so, I want you to live forever underneath the sky so blue. Like, and it was just, we were like, okay, this is our moment. We got the follow-up call from her team that said, okay, so we're going to take your voices out of it. We really just want to use the guitar, like the instrumental. And it's going to be like 20 seconds. And it's actually not going to be a national campaign anymore. They're going to play it before movies start in movie theaters. There goes our last chance of opportunity.
Just career like is over.
On top of the world, being like, I can't wait to be interviewed by Oprah. Like, she's going to be my new best friend. And then, man, it was so disheartening. And at that point, our van had broken down. We didn't have money to fix it. And we were borrowing cars to finish our gigs. And so I remember having this conversation right after that letdown moment. Drew just took a deep breath and he was like, you know what? I don't want to be bitter. I'm so grateful for every memory that we've gotten to make together on the road. It's been a good ride. We can't afford to fix our van. We're having to borrow cars to go finish the rest of our gigs. I think it's probably time to hang it up. Hmm. And you can go back to teaching. He started training to be in the Marines because he wanted, that was the only way he could figure out how to get paid to go to law school. So he was like, I'll do the Marines. Comes from a lot of military in his family. So he had started like literally physically training to pass the test to start applying for the Marines.
Are you starting to prep yourself to like, okay, I'll go back to teaching? Or were you still interested in trying to like make this music thing
work? Oh, no, no. I was hands down ready to teach. And I was like, I'll be a mom. My mom was a stay-at-home mom. And she was amazing. She was just awesome. And so I had like, I was like, oh, I'll teach until we have kids. And then I'll have kids and be a mom, yeah. A Marine mom. Ugh. I wasn't like super stoked about that. But it was sort of the way we were going to make things work. And then we get another call. And it's our friend, Paul Roper, helps run Dual Tone Records. And he's just a friend of ours from church. He had heard Live Forever and pitched it to this show called Parenthood. And Parenthood ends up saying, we want to use this for this montage at the end of season episode 8. It's an episode called Namaste. And they pay you for it, which comes in the mailbox and you didn't have to do anything. We ended up watching through Parenthood and you never know how they're going to use your song or in what way. And man, it is this beautiful scene. And we're like crying, listening to our song. And all of a sudden the check comes in and it was like nothing we had ever seen before. And it's not like it was $1 million check. It wasn't that, but it was enough for us to buy a van. And so we bought a Parenthood van, and literally
you get all the actors' faces on the side.
Yep, it was sponsored by Parenthood, and Adam Braverman his face was on the side. Here's what was even crazier about that. I remember we played Athens, Georgia at the 40 Watt, and we showed up for this show, and there were like 350 people there. And we were like, who are these people? And, you know, we go out selling our own merch at this point, you know, out. And we're like, hey, why are you here? How do you even know about us? And they're like, oh, Parenthood. And all of a sudden, this sort of growth started happening. And so we had prayed, you know, if we're supposed to keep doing this, like, you're going to have to make it really clear. And bam, Parenthood van, Parenthood placement happens. And all of a sudden, people start, we're like, well, maybe we're supposed to keep doing this crazy music thing. So deeply grateful.
When did it switch from like Drew Holcomb to Drew and Ellie Holcomb to like Drew Holcomb and the Neighbors?
Great question. Yeah, the Neighbors came along that first year when I quit my teaching job. It was Drew Holcomb and the Neighbors because we all lived in the same neighborhood in Nashville at the same time. And I just called myself a neighbor with benefits. You know, it's just like life insurance, getting to be married to the lead singer. And so I was just this like utility player, background singer girl, and loved being along for the ride. Fast forward to the beginning of me making music was at this show. It was a sold-out show, first sold-out show in Knoxville. 500 people are in the room. So this is like things are starting to hit. I remember going to check on the merch girls, and I walked out, and I can sort of hear the crowd excitedly murmuring. And they're like, oh, my gosh, look what she's wearing. Oh, my gosh, there's Ellie. That's Ellie. Just this sense of like, I'm like, guys, it's just me. It's your friend who you've been coming to see shows for. We've been begging you to come, remember, for all the years. And all of a sudden, I felt this sense of, like, people were excited to see me. And Drew and I have been married for probably 4 years at this point. And I walked out on the stage. People are going crazy. The room is standing room only. It feels electric in there. And before Drew, you know, Drew says, "Hello, Knoxville." And I can hear all these people talking about whatever dress I was wearing. And then I remember putting my dress had pockets in it at the time. And I put my hands in my pockets. And then I felt like I heard this murmur of like, "Oh, it has pockets, pockets, pockets." And I was just like, "Oh my God, it does have pockets," you know? And all of a sudden, I had this thought. Drew had, at this point, Drew is an amazing man. He is not, at this point, a very tender-hearted man. And had hurt my feelings a lot, not on purpose. And so I was not good at having conflict. I had no idea how to have conflict. So he would hurt my feelings. I would never say anything because I just was like, keep the peace, keep the peace. But I was a pretty like wounded bird and had a lot of wounds from my past that I had never dealt with. Mm-hmm. And therefore a lot of insecurities and wounds that had never been tended to. When your marriage becomes something that is literally a performance on stage, I had this thought. I was like, all these people in this room think that I am amazing. What the hell is wrong with you? I had this deep feeling in me. I was like, that thought is the beginning of a divorce. In my mind, I knew not all these people actually know me. He actually knows me and sees me not just performing and all bright and shiny. And this is like amazing show, very surreal show for me because it was so fun. All these people cheering, listening to us, singing along. Mm-hmm. And then I go backstage and I am like, Drew, I had this thought. And he's like, whoa, that's kind of intense. And I was like, I think I might need to go to counseling. And he was like, yeah, I think that's a great idea. And, you know, a couple months later, ended up booking my first session at Porter's Call, which is free counseling for full-time artists and musicians. And I literally showed up. I just said, I actually am here because I have this friend going through a really hard time. I was like, that girl.
I'm just visiting for advice about my messed up friend.
Yeah. I'm a really good friend. And I just want to know how to love them.
She has dresses with pockets.
Yeah, she's dresses with pockets. And so I end up talking, sharing my heart. And at the end of the counseling session, she said, I need you to think about salsa. And she was like, so I know you came in here to talk about your friend, but you are actually in need of intensive counseling. We can do that in a couple different ways. Mild salsa would be you coming in here once a year and we can kind of assess things, talk through issues that you've had, friends, problems that you're working through. She was like, mild would be like a need to know basis. So if there's a conflict, you know, that you have that you want to learn how to talk through, we can come in here and talk through that. Or hot salsa would look like laying out your personality across the gospel, exposing some pretty serious, like unhealthy patterns that are in your life that you have no idea are there. It will be so hard every time you come in. And you will probably not want to come back every time. She was like, so you could choose mild or medium, but if you do that, in 10 to 12 years, your life will fall apart. Or you can choose hot. Totally up to you. And with fear and trembling, I kind of remember just raising my hand. I don't know why I did this, but I was like, hot. And I remember crying in the car on the way home. It was a long drive, which was really great to have time to process. Every time I ended up driving down to Franklin to that little house by the railroad tracks that they were in at the time, I remember feeling so relieved. I felt like she gave me permission to not be okay, finding a home and a space for me to sit with my pain, which I wasn't very good at. And I think that was where every song that I ever would end up writing came from, was me being willing to sit with sorrow.
What, if that was the seed, what was the first leaf?
Yeah. Oh, I love that. What Nita helped me do was to be a human.
What were you before?
I was good. I was good at being good. I call myself a recovering perfectionist. And I thought that the gospel was all about me loving God enough and loving other people enough. And I was pretty okay at that. But any sorrow or conflict that I ever had, just I was like, God is good, and got swallowed up by his goodness and everything was fine. The eternal optimist. I was given the book, The Gifts of Imperfection by Brené Brown, and learned that it is very hard to stand up in the brokenness of your own story, but it is a hell of a lot harder to spend your life running from it. And I was good at running. I was really good at running from anything that was hard or painful. Fast forward, I think the first leaf from that was I was with a friend of mine, a girl at Young Life Camp. We were still volunteering in the summer. I've done that for 10 summers, for 1 to 3 months. But I remember sitting with a girl's story who battled depression. And that was so scary and dark to me. And I think what I learned in counseling is that I could not only sit with my own sorrow, but I could sit with other people's sorrow as well and not have to make it better right away. I think what was born in me via counseling was the gift of psalms and songs that were able to sit in the sorrow. And I wrote one of my first songs for the friends of mine battling depression called The Valley. I knew it wouldn't really be for Drew's band. Drew's in this like Americana storytelling, beautiful world. This was felt more like a psalm. I'm like sitting down with King David, you know, like stealing all his lyrics, you know, and reworking them. And that became a really healing thing for me. And I will never forget going back to Young Life Camp. The first time Eve Sarrett, who's on Young Life staff, I played the song for her. And she says, we need to sing this at camp. This is a song that every kid needs to sing. And I was like, oh, no, Eve, no one knows it. You know, I just wrote it. Like, I just wrote it for my friend Annie. Like, it's not for everyone. It's for her. And she was like, no, this is for everybody. And Annie was there. She was on summer staff. So she said, no, you're going to sing this for the summer staff. So she had me play it for the college kids, passed out lyrics to everybody.
And they're the ones who were like, running the ice cream shop and like the coffee shop
in the morning. The lifeguard at the pool.
Right.
They volunteer and to facilitate the camp activities.
Right.
Yeah. So Eve was the head of the college kids and she was like, we're going to sing this at worship at our meeting tonight. I will never forget hearing those college kids sing that. And Eve said, we need to sing this at club tonight with the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of high school kids who are here. And I was like, Eve, no, they don't know it. And she said, it won't matter because I'm going to have all the college kids stand in the back of the room. So if they don't know it, at least the college kids will sing it. Don't think I can face this morning. There's this heaviness that's on my chest.
You say that you lift this burden. Well, I am begging you to bring me rest. So come.
Singing a song that I wrote with the whole room full of high school kids, seeing them connect with it. It was almost too much. Like I had to turn away. Like I turned my back because I could not stop crying. I just thought, what? Something I wrote that I just thought I needed and my friend needed is something that maybe all of these hundreds of other kids needed too? That's crazy.
Well, I mean, it's like your revelation in counseling that it was okay to be human. And then you put all of those sentiments into this beautiful song, giving everyone in that room permission to be human, as well.
Yeah. Is it C.S. Lewis that says the beginning of any true friendship are the words "me too"?
Mm-hmm.
That song and experience sort of unleashed this thing for me that I was like, oh. And then it helped me process doubt, process sorrow, process pain. It was so powerful for me. Drew and I got pregnant 6 years into this journey. Things are going great. We're going to bring her on the road with us. We do music, and home will be where we are. And y'all know that very well. I was just pregnant with her, and I had started to write all these songs. And I was also memorizing scripture with my friend, Annie, who I wrote The Valley for. We were sitting across each other one day at camp. I was listening to her believe all these lies, and I just thought, that's not true about who God is. That's not true about who you are. And then I'm like, oh my goodness, I'm believing all these same lies. And I got mad, y'all, like angry. And I was like, you know what? The enemy is called the father of lies. And when he speaks, lies are his native language, that freaking punk. And I was like, and I am so sick of him stealing our joy, our peace, the John 10:10, the life to the full that God comes to offer us. And I'm not going down and out without a fight. And you need to pull out your journal right now. And she was like, yes, ma'am. And I start flipping through my Bible, looking for anything I'd ever underlined before. Write this down. She's like, okay. So we start at camp memorizing scripture together. It started changing us. And it didn't take her depression away. It didn't change her circumstances, but it was giving us solid ground to stand on, to anchor down, and to find shelter under when the shame storm started rolling in. I had so much trouble memorizing it. Like, it was really, really hard for me, but I'm like, I can sing 1,000 songs easy, easy. And so I started practicing sitting in God's word and letting songs come out. I was also trying to tour with Drew and write for his band. Well, every time I sat down to write a song or to start a song idea for Drew's band, I was pregnant with Emmy Lou, and I would go to Drew and be like, I started writing this song, and I accidentally wrote another one about Jesus. Like, I'm so sorry. And it kept happening. I kept being like, I started this song idea, and it's my faith. I just keep working out my faith in song. And so I don't know that I needed this permission, but he said, Elle, please know, you do not need to just write for my band. If that is in you, just write, babe. You don't have to write for me. Just write. Write what's in you. Let it out. I don't know why, but when he said that, it was like the floodgates opened. By the end of 9 months, I had this little baby girl to hold and probably 45 new songs.
Wow.
That I had written that I loved. By the time Emily Lou was 6 months, she'd been to 32 states in Canada. And then by the time she was a year, she'd been to most of those 32 states again. They were not glamour touring days. She was in a van. She lived in her car seat.
God bless.
We could not afford a bus. And so we were driving up to a family wedding in an RV with Drew's family. I was so exhausted. We had just taken Emmy Lou in for her 2-month checkup and found out she had hip dysplasia. So she had to be in this little brace. She looked like a little frog. I had the same thing when I was a little girl. It's, as it turns out, hereditary. And that was just like a heavy, anytime you're going into the children's hospital with your baby, that's heavy.
Yeah.
And I know that's close to your heart. You send beautiful lullaby CDs to kids in hospitals. It's amazing. Because it's such a heavy, intense time that no parent wants to be in that situation. And she obviously was going to be just fine, but it felt scary and heavy, and the weight of parenting felt scary and heavy. You're so new at it, and you don't know exactly what you're doing yet. You're figuring it out. And I remember being so nervous about getting her out in the RV. I didn't know if it was like okay to have her out of her car seat in the RV. That felt dangerous. And so instead of nursing her, I'm like, I'm in an RV bathroom pumping, just standing there so exhausted. And I'm like, this is getting ready to be my life. We were going to be in a bandwagon that we had rented, which is basically a semi truck with an RV in the back. But I was just like, I do not know how I'm going to do this. I am so exhausted. And I did what I sometimes do when I'm desperate. and needing some truth, I pulled up my Jesus Calling app and I was like, today's verse is going to be just the exact thing that I need. I'm like holding the breast pump, standing, you know, trying to look at Jesus Calling. And I like look at it and it's the first time ever. I'm like, this is not what I need. And I was like, God, I need to hear from you. I am exhausted and I don't know how I'm going to do this. And I felt like I heard the voice of the Lord say, go take a nap. I was like, well,
praise
that's
be
not
to
God.
God.
Like, praise be to God. I'm like, but that's not you, Lord. That's just me, right? Like, that's just like my body telling me what I need to do. And so, but I didn't feel like I could ask for a lot of help. But I thought me is the mom. I needed to give her the bottle. So I hand the bottle to Drew and I'm like, I'm going to go take a nap. And he's like, great. No one was telling me that I couldn't take a nap. Everybody was there to help me. I just didn't feel free to ask for it. So I climb up above the driver's seat in that little bed and I lay down like fetal position and I just, tears are streaming down my face. And I am scared. And I'm like, how are we supposed to do this music thing that I feel like you've made a way for at this point? Like, we're supposed to do this. I feel called to this, but I feel so overwhelmed by being also called to be this little girl's mom. And I don't know how to do it perfectly. And I just want to do it. If there's anything I want to get right, it's this. And I felt like I sensed God saying, even though I've given you the job of being Emmy Lou's mom and taking care of her and raising her up in the way that she would go, she is my daughter, and I am going to take such good care of her. And I mean, y'all, I'm just sobbing. Okay, okay. And then this, which was maybe even more important, even though I've given you the job of being Emmy Lou's mom, you are still my daughter, and I am going to take such good care of you. And that is a moment in a fetal position above the driver's seat in that little bed in that RV. That is a moment that I go back to this day. When I am in the tension of the call to do this work that I feel like he's given me to do and to be a mom, and how to possibly hold all those things up at the same time. And a lot of times I don't. I let go of work a lot to hold on to my babies a lot. I say no to a lot to draw near to them. And that has been a beautiful rhythm to learn. That is a moment that shifted everything for me as a parent. Thank God it happened early on.
The idea that you are his daughter as well, what does that practically mean for you if you're revisiting that and that felt like such a significant revelation for you?
Yeah, it's a great question. So that would take us all the way back to me being a kid. I would be at my bedroom window waiting up till really late in the night for the headlights of Dad's car to pull in the driveway. This really cool job of being a producer, of making music that was impacting the world. He worked with Amy Grant, who was like my idol, even though like we grew up going to the beach with her, around her, just always knowing her, but just like every other kid in the 80s and 90s, every other little girl wanted to be her. You're just like, she's the best. And she really is just the best. I saw two things as a kid, that music had the power to bring hope and to bring life and light into the world. And I also saw as a kid that music had the power to take my dad away from our family and to take families away from each other. I'm like, ooh, note to self, I do not want to do this when I get older, because if you're a musician, you have to leave home all the time. I always knew that my dad loved me, always knew that he loved me. But if he were here, he would say he was a workaholic. He was so passionate about this job. And honestly, we were all passionate about it too. We were like, go, Dad, you are so awesome. Half the time we'd be leaving for school and studios rented out for 24 hours at a time. And he would be pulling in to get a couple hours sleep and then go back to the studio. And I'm the oldest of five kids. There were a lot of us. And man, Mom was amazing, but he was gone. He missed a lot of my childhood. And it was when I was in college. Mom got his attention, basically, you know, and was like, so either you're coming home or the locks will be changed and you won't be able to get in because you need to be here. And y'all probably heard him share this story with you. And I want to be respectful of not telling too much of his story, but as his child, when he came home and God just turned his heart towards home, I will never forget him saying, I am so sorry. I've missed out on so much. And I wish I could go back and do it differently. And all I can do is say, I am here. I can give you repentance and to just say, I got it wrong. And I can give you Jesus who loves us enough not to leave us as we are. And so I remember being in college being like, awesome, Dad, welcome home. It's pretty great around here. Like, we have so much fun and we love it every time that you're here. And there was all this healing. And when I started making my own music, it was so beautiful. I've made every record that I've ever made with him in the room. He came on my first radio tour when we did that. I remember us being on the radio together saying, God has restored the years that the locusts have eaten. And so when I heard God say that as you're my daughter, my biggest fear was, if I do this, if I do my own music, this will destroy your family. Mm. You know, part of it's a lie and part of it's like, it is hard. Music is hard. It's hard. There's a lot of moving pieces to it and it can be hard on families and it is hard on our family at times, for sure. We're always assessing and reassessing and canceling plans and being like, oh, we did not do that right. We got to change this rhythm up. But it's been a journey to have to trust to go back to that moment where I was listening to the Lord saying, I'm going to take good care of your kids. I'm going to take good care of you, my kid, as I call you into this work that I've given you to do. Because I still get scared, you know, I still get scared. But I'm learning that he has all the time for me, a limitless amount of time to spend with me. And so I think that daughter piece is something that plays into it's okay to not be okay.
Can you tell us about leaving the band?
This was a year-long process for me. The first moment happened when I was very pregnant with Emmylou. I was on bed rest. It was the first time that Drew got to open for Need to Breathe. I was supposed to be out on the road with him, but I got sent home by the doctor and because Emmylou tried to come early. And Drew was the first of three opening for Need to Breathe. Actually, I think the first of four, which that's even worse because no one's there. Most people aren't listening. But it's also this amazing opportunity to maybe convert some fans. I got released from bed rest, pretty much 9 months pregnant. And I decided to go drive and just watch Drew from side stage. He's at the Orange Peel in Asheville. It's a sold out room. Everybody happened to already be there.
Wow.
He was going to invite me up to sing a song with him. Just one song. I could barely breathe because pregnancy. But I remember standing side stage, watching him hold that entire room in the palm of his hand. And I realized, I've never watched you do this without me next to you. Because if I'm ever with you, you have me on stage. And all of a sudden, I was literally like, oh, please don't invite me to sing with you. I just want to watch the delight and wonder of who you are hold this room captive. You are incredible. It was a big deal for him because we had been singing together for so long and built this career together.
Did you end up sharing that with him right after?
I got the courage to share how I felt in that moment so deeply approximately 1 year later. We were in the Hamptons. Our friends have a house up there, and we were going to spend some time with them. We had just gotten off tour with Need to Breathe. Emmylou, from 3 to 7 months, she grew up in the bandwagon. She had started walking and was in a car seat for 6 hours a day. We had lobster rolls, and we had a great bottle of champagne that we bought from a local wine shop. Emmylou's just walking so happy all over this home and just exploring. And I'm just watching her as a little girl. And I'm like, we're not in a bus. She has to be in her car seat when we're traveling. So I got the courage to say to Drew, we're having all this momentum. We're living the dream. You know, a year ago, I watched you play. You are incredible. And as I watch Emmylou wanting to walk, I can't help but wonder. I've been writing all these songs. I'm loving it. This is like the most vulnerable question I've ever asked him. But I'm like, do you ever feel like having me next to you on stage hems you in a bit? I don't know. Have you ever wondered what it would be like if I wasn't there? And he's like, whoa, no, not really. But now that you say that, I mean, that was a big deal for me to know that I could do it without you, because it's always been the thing has been us together. And I was like, babes, it's a great thing when we're together. I was like, but I'm feeling this like pull to get Emmylou home. I just feel like I can't have her in a car seat. What if I just kept writing songs and just was like, stayed home with our girl, and I could still come sing with you every now and then, but I don't know, what do you think? And he's like, I don't know, that sounds kind of like an adventure. Going to Al Andrews, Porter's Call, and we go and we're like, okay, this is gonna sound crazy, Al. And we may be like tanking our career. And I said, but I think not, because I've seen Drew by himself and he's pretty great. But we're thinking of just letting Ellie stay home. But we're idiots, right? Things were happening. This is like momentum. This is like the dream is happening. And I'm like feeling this call to get my girl home and to just be with her and watch her run through the yard and be a normal kid and not have to be like in a bar, you know, like we were in clubs and bars. I'd like warmed up her milk bottle and like shot glasses all over the country, you know. Poor thing, she slept in a suitcase. And Al teared up. And he said, you are doing something that is so important. You are individuating. And we were like, what the heck does that mean? And he was like, you're just each being who God called you to be. Drew, you're giving Ellie like permission to write what's in her. That looks different than what's in you. And it's so important that both of you are exactly who God made you to be and who are in the spaces that God created you to be in. And those may be different spaces. That may be the home, and that may be the like clubs and theaters, and that's okay that that's not together. I think this is beautiful, and I toast you. And we were like, Al, it's also scary as hell. Like, here we are, we're finally like maybe financially sort of making some income, and then literally, well, let's take a gamble. What if I left and became a stay-at-home mom? And that was wild. We were on pins and needles waiting to see if it worked. Now that I look back on it, most of the things that scared me the most have been some of the best decisions, because it felt right. And I think that was probably one of the most powerful things we ever could have done for our marriage. I know, as it turns out, now I have this whole other music career, kids, because there's all these other things that happened in the wake of that that probably wouldn't have happened if we didn't do that. And I think I'm a better mother and a better wife and a better human because of it. I really thought that I was going to go to Wheaton College. I had a hunch that I wanted to be an English teacher, and they had a great English program. But I remember visiting the college, and I'm a big late night owl, and oh my gosh, I love people. And I was so excited to go to another college and meet so many more people. I went and visited Wheaton, and I was calling my mom and dad, like just excited about what I was seeing. And I got told to be quiet on the payphone by several people who were in the dorm. I was staying in the dorm with another college student, and they were like, "We're studying." And I was like, "This may not be my place, actually." So I was looking at Wheaton and being in debt and being told to be quiet at 10:30. And then the University of Tennessee was free. And that's where I met Drew. I was coming down the steps. Drew was coming up. This was in my freshman year. I said, "Hey, I'm Ellie. What's your name?" And he was like, "My name's Drew." We had a lot of mutual friends. And I was like, "What'd you do today?" And he goes, "Actually, I flew a plane by myself for the first time today." He got an appointment at the Naval Academy. He wanted to fly more than anything, but he was 18 looking at 32. And he was like, "I just don't know if I can like commit to the military thing." So he had always considered that. So he had gone back to that when music didn't work out. So Drew asked me to go to this fraternity formal in Charleston, North Carolina. Asked my parents for permission. He was like, "I'll sleep on the couch. I'm totally going to respect your daughter, but this is a really fun party." I had my heart broken by this guy in high school and was totally still in love with this high school guy, which is why I was writing all the Taylor Swift songs at the time. And I went to this formal with Drew. We had the time of our lives. Everybody was partying on the beach, and we were like the biggest nerds, like going to take pictures around historic Charleston. Like, we did a history tour. Like, we danced like crazy on the dance floor. Like, the best time ever. Came home from that weekend and was just like, "Man, that guy is unbelievable." Afterwards, I was like, "Hey, I just want to let you know I'm not really interested in dating anybody. I'm still kind of processing this heartache thing, pretty unhealthy with guys unintentionally just leading people on. This guy had said he wanted to marry me in high school. He left, just broke up with me for no reason. And so I think I had this void that I was trying to fill, like, would you want to marry me? And finding a husband was an idol for me. But I wrote a song called Charleston, which is the song that I was playing in the stairwell when all those girls were crying, saying like, "I miss the ship again." Like, you watch the ships come and go in the Bay of Charleston. And I was like, "I've let this good thing go, this like amazing guy, because I'm too broken."
How much later after you wrote that song did you guys end up like formally starting to date?
4 years in like a terribly horrible broken relationship with another guy.
Oh, wow.
Who I almost married. Had the ring, but broke up on the day he was supposed to propose.
Wow. Did you know it was coming?
I knew it wasn't good. I knew we were not in a good spot. It was a really unhealthy relationship.
Did Drew have any other relationships after Charleston?
Just one, not anything serious, but Drew was always like, "I'm gonna see about that girl with me." He just was always pretty. He says he dated me for 4.5 years before I dated him back. And it was so beautiful. You know, the guy ended up ending the relationship because he had young life leaders in his life who were saying, "You've pretended to be a lot of things that you're not to get this girl to even date you. And do you want to pretend for the rest of your life?"
Yeah.
And he didn't. He's on this like healed path and married with kids. And it's so great. We were just, you know, wounded people wound people. And that was his story. When that ended, I fell head over heels in love with God because I couldn't believe he wanted anything to do with me. God found me. I was reading Redeeming Love by Francine Rivers.
Oh, yes.
As cheesy as that sounds, but just weeping my way through it. And I fell head over heels in love with God. It was so beautiful because I saw Drew after this relationship ended. It was super embarrassing. All our friends knew each other. It just was like super humbling and hard circumstance. But I saw Drew. When I saw him, you know, we had obviously drifted apart because it was very clear I was going to like marry this other guy. So we were not talking as much. And I saw him and I was like, "I have missed you so much." Like, and just gave him the biggest hug. And he says when I hugged him that day, he was like, "Oh, crap. I am done." He just felt more like my dearest friend and brother. Like, I just had him in that zone. I used to go to all his shows and would jump up and sing with him some.
So he was doing music already.
He was pursuing music already, yeah. He played a show in Nashville at the Sutler. And he played this song called "A Light to Be With Me When I'm With You." And we were not dating. We were just friends at this point. But I didn't breathe for the entire song. And I thought, oh my gosh, this is so weird because that's how I feel about him. But I don't see him romantically at all. But I kind of hope that song's about me. And that night he sat me down and he said, "I know that you're hurt. But I also need you to know that song that I sang tonight is definitely about you. And I'm crazy about you and have been really forever. I know that you're not really in a place that you need to date right now. I know that you're healing, and I just need you to do everything you need to do to be healthy and work through your stuff with the Lord or whatever." And he was like, "But I do think that I have earned the first shot to take you on a date when you're ready to go. And so, no pressure. I'm here. Just let me know whenever you're ready." And it was 6 months after that conversation. We were at an Emmylou Harris concert at Double Decker in Oxford. And he was like, "You think you're ready now?" And I was like, "I am." He was like, "Good, because I have tickets to see Patty Griffin at the Ryman on May 14th. Well, the Ryman Auditorium is the mother church. It's the birthplace of country music. It's in downtown Nashville, and I was scared to go on a date with Drew because I didn't want to ruin this friendship that we had. I said to Mom, I was like, "You know, anytime I think about dating any other guy, I just start crying because I would feel so sad to not be able to be friends with Drew again, like we've been able to be friends." And she was like, "I think that's a pretty good sign that you should give that a shot at least. Like, you should let him take you out, because if that's how you feel, like, you probably need to see about that before you date anybody else." Ellie and I just thought, what a great piece of advice. Like, just go see. It may not be the thing, but it might be the rest of your life. So maybe just go try. And so 6 months after that time, we went on our first date. And so we walked into that Patty Griffin concert, and it was the wildest thing, y'all. He grabbed my hand going to walk in, and I just thought, oh no, it's not like this. We're not like this. This is too weird. You're like my buddy. You know, we don't hold hands. Like, this is, but over the course of a concert, sitting in the back row of the balcony at the Ryman, something shifted, and I knew in the deepest part of me that I was going to spend every day for the rest of all of my days with this man.
Just going back to you guys now having performed on that stage, when you step into that room, what do you think about?
Oh, man. When we first played together on the Ryman stage, I looked up to exactly where we sat. We got to sing and hear our voices echo off of every single broken part of our stories and be multiplied. We have the privilege of singing beauty and truth, even in the valleys, even in the canyons, and watching God multiply that into something beautiful. 6 months after that Patty Griffin concert, we were engaged. And 6 months after that, we were married. And then 6 months after that, we were in a deer blind, deciding to begin this crazy music journey that we thought would be a year. And here we are 15 years in, making music and raising babies. It's kind of wild.
What and where and who do you think you would be if you went to Wheaton College and they loved you?
You know, the narrative that I have in my mind is that I would have met Frank. I know that sounds crazy.
Like, you've actually thought about this?
Yeah. Okay. I really have.
Tell us about Frank.
Frank is Drew's cousin. Here's what would have happened. If I had gone to Wheaton College, I would have met Frank. And he was one of the people at Wheaton who stayed up late at night and loved music, just like Drew. And he and Drew were really close. So My theory is I would have stayed up late, I would have found a friend in Frank, and I would have met Drew anyway. Getting together. But I literally did work it out in my head. I'm like, I can't imagine not meeting you and not knowing you. And what's crazy is I think back to watching a show in the Ryman Auditorium, being transported, realizing I'm going to spend the rest of my life with this man, having no idea that we would ever play music together and then play music on the Ryman stage together. There have been some full circle moments in our story. This gift of being alive with this human next to me, Drew, that I love, and of making music and life and memories and stories together has been remarkable.
Hey, remember at the beginning how I told you about this part?
Yes.
That was supposed to be the end. That's like where we normally end. But Ellie didn't think so because she had another amazing story to tell us.
Yeah, so good.
So this next segment is only recorded into my phone, but the story is too good to pass up. This is the reason why we have this show, is stories like this.
That's right.
I listened to this song called Language of the Heart when I was in college, and it held up a mirror to me of what I was unintentionally doing. It was a song that he wrote about a girl that led him on. And I was the girl that was leading all these people on, and I had no idea. And all of a sudden I heard that song and I started weeping because I heard his hurt in the song. And I just realized, oh my goodness. I've been speaking the language of the heart and unknowingly connecting on this deep soul level with people who think that I want to marry them. And I don't have any interest in that at all. And so I will never forget listening to that song and feeling so known and seen and exposed in a way, but in a way that really caused change, like changed the trajectory of how I behaved. It's why I had the conversation with Drew. I don't want to lead you on. I've been in a really unhealthy place. I had so much fun with you, but I need to go get some things right in my heart. It was because of Language of the Heart by David Wilcox. You said you always were honest. Ooh, sorry. It makes you tear up. And you said that you always were honest, that your words were clear from the start, but you were speaking an unspoken language. It was language of the heart. Oh, man. At the end of the song, he says, I wish you could just play it, because his voice breaks at the end of it. He said, you're speaking in unspoken language. I thought it was true. I thought that you knew.
Yeah, it's one that we all learn by heart, and our hearts think it's true. But you can say that you always were honest, and your words were clear from the start. But it's more than just words that got spoken. There was language of
like someone completely undressed me. I just was like, oh my goodness. I feel so exposed, convicted, like saddened, and I have to behave differently. Yeah, spirit was moving through the words and the guitar of David Wilcox. And it is what, you know, slowed down the relationship with Drew, but I think ultimately brought me to a healthier, more healed and whole version of myself.
How did you stumble across that song?
You know, we had this vibrant community in college, tons of friends who loved music. That's how it is in college. You're like, oh, you have to listen to this. You have to listen to this. Somebody played Eye of the Hurricane for me. And I just was floored by that song. And so I had actually like gone to the local independent record store, and I bought a David Wilcox record. And so I was just listening on Discman, walking around my college campus, which was one of my favorite things to do,
I mean, heard that song and it stopped me literally in my tracks. And I was weeping at the end of it and knew that I would need to be a different human.
Do you feel like your relationship with Drew might be different if you never heard Language of the Heart?
100%.
How?
I had a lot of people telling me that I was being unhealthy, my friends. People speaking this, they're like, I'm not sure that you're so healthy, but there was something about that song that snuck in through the back door and turned the lights on. I think my story with Drew would have been different because I probably would have hurt him. I had hurt a lot of people and burned a lot of bridges unknowingly. I didn't know that I was doing it. I wasn't trying to lead people on, but I think I probably would have played out that same pattern with him. Here's what happened in the wake of it. I told him I didn't want to date him. My heart was not in a great place. And he said, that's great. I'd just love to be your friend. For me, any relationship with another man was always, there was this like unknown, like, are you the guy? Are you going to be the guy? And I'm very friendly and outgoing and love listening to people's stories. Well, what happened with Drew is he said, I would love to be your friend. And I said, great, let's be friends. But what happened is, I wasn't a very good friend to him after that. He really was just trying to be my friend. I thought he was trying to date me. So I always said no to hanging out with groups of people or going to music festival together. He would just invite me on group stuff, trying to be my friend. Well, finally, he gets pretty frustrated with me. He's talking to his mentor about it. He's like, yeah, this girl, I really love her. She's so great. She told me she just wanted to be friends. He said, and she's just like not being a very good friend to me, honestly. Drew was mad. His mentor said, well, you can go. If you're really a friend, you can say you're not being, you can have that conversation. So Drew sits me down at Long's Drugstore, which is an amazing, like flipping pancakes, greasy place in a strip mall in Knoxville. And I've been pretty rude and short with him and basically neglected any text that he ever sent. And because I just was like, oh no, he likes me probably, which I will say I was right about, but he wasn't trying to date me. I saw him. I said, hey, Drew, what's up? Kind of an awkward situation because I knew I had not texted him back a couple of times. He was like, hey, I need to talk to you about something. I'd like to take you to breakfast. And I was like, oh, okay. So in his mind, he's going, I'm going to just like deliver it to this girl and then like be done with it, you know? So he's like, hey, you told me that you wanted to be my friend and you actually have been a terrible friend to me. Like, I promise you, I'm not trying to date you. I'm just trying to be your friend. And I feel pretty hurt, actually, by the way, that you've treated me. And he's ready for me to just write him off and kind of walk out and storm out. And I just was like, oh my goodness, I am so sorry. You're right. I've been a terrible friend and I would actually love to be friends with you. And he says it was at that moment that he was like, well, crap, now I'm in love with her. And I don't know that I had ever, I honestly think Language of the Heart never made this connection before until this moment. I love that you're asking this, Dave, but I think Language of the Heart cleared out the junk in my own heart to help me be able to know what a friendship would look like. And I got to experience that with Drew. And there was this clarity that happened because I was bold enough to say, I've led a lot of people on and I'm learning this. I think if it wasn't for that song, I wouldn't have known how to maybe have a healthy friendship with a guy. Drew was probably the first like healthy friendship with a guy that I'd ever had. And it was the beginning of the sweetest friendship that I've ever known. And so I'm so grateful. So, Dave Wilcox, if you're listening, thank you for Language of the Heart. Set some things free in me. It's amazing. Wow, I feel like we just dug up some treasure. Yay.
I told you this was a delightful episode.
You were right, JJ. Very right.
I am so glad that Ellie found some time to talk with us because I feel like this conversation was a gift to us all.
Yes, it was not just for you and me.
That's right.
Which is what you meant when you said a gift for us all.
Us all, yeah. Uh-huh. To find out more about Ellie Holcomb, go to ellieholcomb.com.
That's ellieholcomb.com.
This episode of Instrumental was produced by me, JJ Heller.
And me, Dave Heller.
Our theme music is my song, Big Love, Small Moments.
That I helped write. You can always listen to JJ's songs by telling your smart speaker to play music by JJ Heller.
We'll be back next week with another episode of Instrumental, so be sure to subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts.